The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWM podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined this week with the creator of Carnage himself, Crusher Craib. Welcome to the show.
All right, guys. How you going?
I'm doing very well. I'm excited to have you on. You're a man of few words, usually, so it's nice to be able to actually speak to you. But we have had one long conversation when I drove you from Inverness to Aberdeen once. That's about the length of it.
Yeah.
But the first question is always the same. How did you get into wrestling? What got you hooked?
I got to wrestling young because when I was a little kid, my mum watched wrestling, and before I was born, my granddad watched wrestling. So it was always in on the house. You know, like it was always on TV. My mum was like a big fan of Surfer Sting, so I always remember him when I was a kid. So yeah, it pretty much, I got really into it when I started watching WWE, when I saw The Undertaker. Yeah, I was a big fan of him, so that's when I started liking it a lot.
So Surfer Sting and Undertaker, so would that be like old, like the... purple gloves, grey gloves, kind of Undertaker, or was it more into the Attitude Era side of things?
I started watching him about... It was when he had that mask on, when he had purple gloves. The white mask he wore. It was like similar to the one that Bray Wyatt wore. That's when I started watching it.
Oh, and it got his face broken by Mabel, I think it was.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, and then he got the mask ripped off by Bret Hart and one of the Royal Rumble matches, I think it was. So yeah, I think that's when I started really watching it at that point.
All right. So 96, 97, something like that. Right, so how did you go from that to actually actively pursuing to be a wrestler?
I mean, when you're a fan of wrestling, you always kind of want to do it, you know? Even when you're a fan, it's there. You always think, oh, I want to do this. I want to do choke slams. I want to do this. And I think when I got to like the age of 17, 18, I just started looking at schools, and obviously there was none in Aberdeen. So I went down to a training school in Glasgow and I did one seminar, but couldn't really afford to go down all the time, you know? So eventually I found out through some of the guys in Aberdeen that there was a new promotion starting up in Kirkcaldy at the time, which was WrestleZone. And that's when I went down there and started training with them guys. And yeah, it was really good from that point.
I think I've heard before, it's like there was a group here in Aberdeen, they would all just bundle into a car and just...
That was the best part. So like no bus fares, just we all like chipped in like £10 of fuel and we drove down. So yeah, it was good. Good times.
So you're one of the taller guys in Scotland, actually, just for wrestling in general. Did you have a bit of an athletic background before you decided to go for wrestling? Did you do things like basketball, football, anything like that?
Like I did a little bit of football when I was in primary school, but nothing in like secondary school. Like sports wasn't like a really big deal to me. I was just a big fan of wrestling and, you know, obviously, I never tried it until like started training. So, just, I guess I was athletic enough. So yeah.
And how was that first proper training then? So when we did go down to WrestleZone, because I mean, we'll forget about that one session in Glasgow because that's like your intro. I'm assuming a lot of cardio stuff. So how was it like actually doing the bumps and actually doing some of the wrestling?
It was crazy. Like, I think we did like a 5-hour training seminar or something the first time I went down. And I just remember being absolutely dead the next day. Could hardly move. But yeah, no, it was fun. That's when I got to meet Johnny Lyons. And I think when I met him, it was just like, yeah, he's a great guy. he's very welcoming, you know. So like, I think him alone just made me want to come back, and obviously all the Aberdeen guys, I was like good friends with them, so I think I just fit in properly there, so it was good.
I suppose the difference between going down to, like say, going to Glasgow yourself, and you have to chip in for all your expenses, whereas you can pile 5-6 of you into one car, and you can all just trade stories and woes and push each other on. So there's like no excuse where you can't go. It's like, no, it's a tenner. Get in the car.
Definitely. Can't moan of that. It's a tenner there and back. So, you know, it's definitely worth the money.
Absolutely. And Johnny Lyons, I'm hoping I'm going to start trying to actively pursue to get him on the podcast, because I think that would just it would be chaotic.
Funny interview. he's a great guy. He's just nuts, though.
I've heard him do one for Tuck of the Draw, and he relayed his story about being in the cinema, and I really just don't think I could handle an interview with Johnny without just laughing for the majority, and I don't know if he'd be in on the joke. So
that is guaranteed. He's just a funny guy, and yeah, when he tells you some of his cinema stories, it's just hilarious.
Incredible.
Yeah, he's a good dude though. Good dude.
So according to the good folks at Cage Match, the Germans, they say you made your debut in 2009. Are they correct in that?
Yes, they are. Yeah, I think it was about May 2009.
Brian Tucker, it says your first opponent was as well.
No.
Of course that's not right.
My first opponent was Sisto. Match with Sisto, and I think it was Bowness. Bowness Town Hall, and there was like 14 people maybe, and I think that was the most nervous I've ever been for a match, and it's like 14 people. So yeah,
you get that, I suppose. It's if we've got a sea of people, you did have the Anarchy and it's over 1,000 people, so you can't pick out faces, but when there's 14, you're like, there you are. Oh, one of you's left.
Yeah.
So what was it like, what you said, nervous, what was it like going to that first match? And what were you told, and do you think you're ready for it?
No. I even said to the guys, I'm not ready. I'm not ready right now. And they just said, just go out there and, you know, do like what you have to do and get through it. But they says you'll be fine. And I was just like, nah, I'm not ready. I'm not ready. You know, I'm like one of these guys, if I'm training or doing something not even wrestling related, I like to make sure I'm ready before I take the next step, if you know what I mean. Like I need to make sure I know what I'm doing. So it was very nerve-wracking, that's for sure.
And were you always just the big Creator Carnage, the big beast as you came in, or was there a bit of a curve from you starting to get that character?
I was just Crusher Craib, you know. There was no like nicknames. They just says, "Well, go out. You go out there. You have a squash match with Sisto. Do some of your signature moves and go home." You know, that was pretty much it. I mean, before that, we did do we did do some birthday parties, and they just announced me by my own name, and had like a female manager, but like she didn't like last too long. But yeah, that was bizarre as well. Very bizarre.
I know it's funny. It's I don't know if you want me to reveal your real name for everyone to see. But when my wife was like, "Oh, everyone knows, that's fine." Well, nowadays one of the biggest wrestlers in the world is Walter. So it's like,
yes.
but when my wife found out your name, she was like, "Really? I didn't place him as a Walter." It's like,
I get that a lot.
He can still hurt you, probably. Walter or not.
That my name was passed on from my dad. Like, my dad was if he was alive now, he'd probably be about 70 or something. So, yeah, like, you know, it's an older generation name. But I think, in a way, it's kind of cool because you don't get to see anyone my age with that name. So it's kind of new again, in a way. You know?
Absolutely. It's weird. I went through life meeting no Billies, and then now they're just everywhere. I don't know how it's happened. You still can't find my name on things in shops, though, which is the just biggest pet peeve in life. So you went, where did Crusher come from then? Was that just placed onto you, or was that a choice that you made?
I think it was just kind of like you know, like me and the Aberdeen guys were just kind of throwing ideas out, and I actually can't remember who came up with the name. I remember someone says, how about Crusher Crazed? And I was like, no, that's horrible. But I like the name Crusher, so we just added my last name onto it. And it was fine enough. I like that. So,
good bit of alliteration. It wasn't on the actual cage match, but I have a feeling that I remember you telling me about some match you did in like McDuff. Was it just for a camp tour, or like it wasn't All Star, was it? I can't remember. That quite early on?
I think that was 2010. I think it was Power Slam Wrestling. I think it was Jason Rotunda. Well, yeah, it was Jason Rotunda that ran that for quite a few shows. I can't remember what I disliked though. I'm trying to remember.
Jason Rotunda, of course, former ECW star.
Yeah. No, he was a good guy. He was always nice to me. So, yeah.
I just remember.
A good experience.
I just remember going past. Like, I used to drive from Elgin to Newport Sligo every day for work, for ridiculous reasons. I still remember seeing the sign, clear as day, yellow, train with former ECW star Jason Rotunda.
Oh God. Yeah, he's a Carter, that's for sure. Yeah. He was a nice enough guy though.
So that was 2010. I've got brief notes of where we went till I saw you for the first time, which was Aberdeen Anarchy, the first time in the Beach Ballroom. But in the interim of that, you came in, Crusher Craib, and you're affiliated and then kind of joined Sterling Oil. Again, was that just more of a decision? Were you comfortable with like speaking, or was this a way for you to kind of join a group and not have to do as much speaking to a crowd?
Well, I remember when I first started doing squash matches, the guy says just don't speak, you know, because you're doing squash matches, just go through it. And then when I wasn't too comfortable to begin with when I was to, you know, when my matches start getting longer, obviously you need to start speaking, you know, so the crowd doesn't lose interest and stuff. So I think when I really started picking up that is when I actually worked for Jason Rotunda and his Power Slam Wrestling. I wrestled a guy called Cameron Craze from England. And he just basically said to me, he was just talking through like what I should do during the heat and, you know, like what I should say, you know, just little things to try and work the crowd. And I think from that point I got it right away. It was like, yeah, I like that, really good.
I mean, especially for yourself being like doing the squashes and just being the big monster, it doesn't take a lot. You just have to, you're just shouting a lot, but it's all in context, I suppose, at the same time.
That's all I do. Yeah.
So before you won the Regal Rumble, first of three, then you broke away from Sterling Oil and you end up facing Johnny Lyons in the main event of the first Aberdeen Anarchy in the Beach Ballroom. So it's over 1,000 people. So at this point, you would have wrestled maybe a couple hundred, like at Northern or the Summerhill Hotel or what have you. What was it like going into the main event of the first Aberdeen Anarchy, considering there's guys like Billy Gunn and Hacksaw Jim Duggan there?
Oh, man, that was so nerve-wracking, honestly. I mean, the worst part was, because like, we got in at the... I'm sure we got in the venue about 8 a.m. So, like, we had to wait all the way to, like, 9 p.m., half 9, until our match came on, and we were just so tired, but... I just remember pacing back and forth. It was the most nervous I've ever been, and obviously getting to work with Johnny was something I really wanted to do, because I really like Johnny. So yeah, and it was nerve wracking. But the minute I got through the, like, when I went right through, I was fine, totally fine.
This would have been your first title belt as well. I don't know if you're a belt guy, if it's something that is important to you, or it was just a case of, right, I've gotten through it, what's next?
I mean, it was cool, because like I got to, I think the good thing about when I first became the champ was I got to wrestle all these other guys that had obviously a lot more experience, like Big Damo, Jack Chester, you know, all these guys, TJ Rage. And I think when I started wrestling them, I actually started getting a lot better myself. And I started learning better as a big man because I started picking their brain about things. So, yeah, I think, like, as far as the belt, it doesn't really bother me. No, it's just a prop, really. No, it's there. But it's nice to have it in main event and, you know, obviously get longer matches and wrestle people that are a lot more experienced. So, yeah.
It must be a bit of a marked change. I don't know if you had to change your style as much, because it seemed to be, because you're with Sterling Oil, so of course the bad guys, and then of course you broke away with them, so automatically the fans would start cheering for you. But did you find that you had to change much at all, other than maybe do a couple of high fives on the way to the ring?
See, when I first turned babyface, I was like doing what I did as a heel to begin with. I was just doing squashes with the Sterling Oil members, and then when I got to like the first ballroom show, that was my first like long match, and we did the match. There was a spot in the match where Johnny did a drop kick, and my leg was hooked in the rope, and like my whole body just went upside down. It looked like I broke my leg, and then Johnny goes to whip me, and I hit the turnbuckle. When we got backstage, Billy Gold wasn't happy because he was like, he just did that massive spot, you should have whipped him. And so we got a bit chewed out, and but like once Billy, he was just trying to like, you know, help us, and he said to me, he's like, you need to learn on your selling. So like from that point, I just said to the guys, when we're at training, I want to work on selling as a big man, because obviously as a heel, you don't really need to do that as much. But obviously when you're a baby face, you're on the ground a lot more. So yeah, I think that was the hardest part about transitioning into a baby face. So yeah.
You did all right for your first run. As far as you kept the belt until next year's Average Anarchy, for possibly one of my favorite stories in WrestleZone, ever, just because it was so simple and yet so effective. Of course, you and Jack Chester. Very easy story. It was just Chester, I think, was he one of the first people to beat you, but it was by DQ. And then you end up getting DQ'd constantly on the run-up to it, because you kept getting up too angry for it. And then it culminated with him hitting you with a chair and tombstoning you. So
yeah,
how much of the process were you involved with that?
Great. Yeah, it was a great story, actually. Like, the first match, obviously, it was all about him playing mind games, and you know, eventually he picked up the corkscrew, and then I picked up the chair, he spat in my face, and then I went nuts and started beating him with a chair. And then obviously that chair got used, the chair came back for the ballroom finish for when he tombstoned me. And, you know, yeah, it was really good. I enjoyed that story a lot. The only thing I would say is I wish the matches were a little bit longer. Like, each time we went back through the curtain, they were like, yeah, that was like 14 minutes. Like, really? Felt a lot longer out there, but yeah, it was really, really fun.
Yeah, I mean, that was, yeah. It was so tense. I was like front row for that one. I can't believe how tense it was, because of course, for those that are not aware and they should get on DVD, Jester pulled one of the camera girls and threatened her with a corkscrew. And then you were like, oh no, don't. And it was like, oh my God, there's a man behind the monster. And I might be reading too much into it, but there was so many layers into that story that I found. I still love how WrestleZone, they have a narrative. It's not like, this is the big show, this is who we've got. There's it makes sense. Is that something you quite enjoy, that there is storylines, so you kind of got your motivation for each match?
Oh yeah, I mean, like, I think that's the one thing I enjoy about WrestleZone. It's more about the storyline and what we can do to progress it. I mean, you can have a match, but you can have like a cold match, but like if the fans aren't into it, I'd rather have like a story to like hold on to, you know. So like fans are into it. I love that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, one example that I'll always pull out is Damien versus Richard R. Russell, which was,
oh yeah,
I think maybe count amazing. Five wrestling moves. That was about it. But the place was just electric.
I remember being in the back and it, honestly, you could just hear how loud that place was. It was so good. So good.
Then we moved on to, you got the title back at Battle of the Nations and you went into... Did you go to Aberdeen Anarchy the next year? As no, you didn't. You lost it to Joe Coffey. Remember now? I'm getting confused. And yeah, because then Swift went. Then year after. So the year after was you win the Regal Rumble again, and facing Scotty Swift. Probably not the best memory for you, and I'm bringing up.
Yeah.
Because the match ended suddenly because of an injury. What were your initial thoughts when it happened and just everything around that?
It just happened really fast. I mean, as soon as I went to the top, I'll say right away, nothing Scott did was wrong. It was all me. When I jumped off, like my legs weren't flat. One leg was up like a little bit bent. So as soon as my knee hit the floor, it just pushed right up into my hip socket. My hip socket, it just exploded. There was all like these little pieces, like in, you know, it was just exploded. Crazy. And as soon as I landed, I knew right away I'm injured. So the worst part about it though is when I landed, I knew I had to roll over at my back. And when you break your hip, it's weird. You only want to stay on the side. Like, you can't lie on your back just because of the way it's, just the way it is. And I just remember, oh God, I have to lie on my back and Scott has to do a bridge over in me. It's going to be awful. So yeah, I just rolled over and just got over with it. So like when Scott was in the middle of the pen, Denzel was counting to three. I said to Dennis right away, look, I'm injured. I know I'm injured. There's something not right. And I think I was in the building for about an hour before an ambulance came because there was like all these parades going on. So I was just lying in a ring. And the worst part is when the adrenaline wore off and I was in so much more pain. It's just crazy. It all just happened so fast. And I mean, when the paramedics came in, I kind of don't really remember much of it because they just gave me like gas and just kind of knocked me out and then put me on a stretcher. And the only thing I remember is when they were stretching me out, Johnny Lyons is like coming over and he's crying. He's like, oh, you're too young. You should have been me. I should have been in your position. I'm like, Johnny, let me go. I'm injured. Leave me alone. And he was just like hugging me. And I'm like, mate, you need to leave me alone. But I just can't remember much. It was just crazy.
Johnny just going, right, no, I'm injured, I'm dead, come, just calm yourself. Oh,
I think he'd been drinking a little bit as well after his match because he was like hugging me and he was like, I love you, bro. And I'm like, oh my god, let me go.
And that went, of course, you're out for, well, till the fall in September. And you kind of, your Facebook page, your fan page, it kind of just went inactive. Were you a little bit just done for wrestling for a little bit while you're healing? Was there a bit of a betterment towards it just because you couldn't do it?
No, I think I was just more... worried about if I couldn't perform the way I wanted to. So I was kind of just waiting to see how my recovery went. I didn't want to post anything just in case I decided to like obviously walk away. And I also thought if I did return, Crusher wouldn't post on social media and stuff like that. So I'll just keep it silent. And when I got injured, I went to every single show, well, as much as I could, and I went to training every week just so I could be around it, you know, just so I didn't want to be like gone from wrestling for like a year. When I come back, I'm like, oh no, there's little things that I'm not remembering, and you know, so I think it was a good thing still being around it. But yeah, no, that's pretty much what happened. Just stayed silent.
And of course, came back September. That was when they did Average Anarchy later in the year, which some liked, some didn't. I didn't care. I got to see wrestling in the ballroom. I'm happy either way. Your announcement, your return was announced, and of course, Big Bad Crusher booted Scotty Swift in the head and joined Sterling Oil again.
Yeah, I love that. I really enjoyed that. I've been a babyface for so long that I just was like, oh my God, I can't wait until I turn. Oh my God, it's going to be great. Yeah.
I remember up in the balcony, because it's the best seat in the house, but I was up in the balcony watching it, and me and Kyle Watt, we were both going, oh, he's going to kick Scotty. And then we were still like, as soon as he did it, we were like, oh my God, he actually kicked Scotty. Amazing.
It was good. I really enjoyed that.
And then you went straight back into going against Scotty again, which involved lots of punches to the head and the world's biggest kendo stick.
Oh, that was in the follow-up match, I think.
That was the
Rumble.
Yeah, the Rumble.
Yeah,
that was a crazy night in itself.
yeah.
But yeah, I remember did you put together the world's largest candlestick? Whose idea was it?
My idea. I've done it before. I done it in, when was it? One Wild Night, you know, the over 18 show we did.
Right.
I wrestled Alan Sterling and we did like a hardcore match. And I was like, yeah. I had a massive kendo stick in that one. That was Alan in that match was just hilarious. And then I took out this massive kendo stick, like what you saw with Scott. And then Malice was with Alan, and Malice pulled out this like little baby kendo stick. That broke me. I was like, oh my God.
I just made me remember Big Show. It was Big Show and Sheamus, and he'd take out this humongous chair that they'd made.
Yes.
or when he had ladder matches, they had the big reinforced one.
And that was crazy, yeah.
I don't know how, I mean, you hit him with it, but I was like, just by the size of it, I don't know how you did it, because there's no way you got any force, but it still made this, like, noise as it hit him.
that's the greatest thing about a kendo, you know, like, you can hit it full force, it only stings for a few seconds, and then that's it.
And then,
that's how it feels.
We got past that. I'm rattling through your wrestling zone stuff here because we do have stuff going around. I got loads of questions in as well, which is always good.
Yeah.
So you're doing that, and Sterling Oil eventually got disbanded at an Aberdeen Anarchy 2018.
Yeah.
I've written down very little of this. I have a very strange encyclopedic knowledge of WrestleZone now, and yeah, went into a feud with Connor Ingalls. Am I saying that right? Connor Ingalls.
Mm-hmm. Connor Ingalls. Ingalls. Yeah, Ingalls.
I feel really bad when I see his name because like I think I know how to say it, but I'm certain I'm wrong at the same time.
I think at one point we've all said it wrong, so it's okay.
he was English for a long time in my notes, or when I was saying it out loud. And this is a very different thing, because you're doing squash matches, but it was a different sort of thing, because, of course, folk were rooting for Connor. I mean, I'm not saying folk wouldn't root for a Sisto, but, you know, it's a different thing.
Yeah.
What's it like working with Connor initially, just as an opponent?
You could tell there's something there, you know. I think once he's been polished up a bit, I think he's going to be really good. But I had my I think the first match was at Summer Hill with him. It was like the Open Invitational, and it was just a squash match, and I just remember when the following week they were like, we're going to put him in the Rumble, and have them eliminate you. And I'm like, yeah, that's good. That'll be a big pop, because no one will expect that, because I've just literally squashed this guy. So yeah. And then obviously it led to like this big feud, and yeah, it was really good. I enjoyed working with Connor. Really good kid.
I was again another favorite Rumble, because Malice died. Caleb was saying that when he did it, he went, "Oh." Was that pretty much the reaction backstage as well when it happened?
Pretty much. We thought the floor had broken. It's like, oh God, what just happened? That everyone thought that Malice was dead, because from our angle, we had a live feed, but we only saw like the back of Caleb, so we just saw Malice go over the top rope, and all we heard was the thump, and it's like, he's dead, he's dead. But yeah, no, that was fun.
We had that, and then of course Connor eliminated yourself, and then had Rudo winning, and then all the chaos with that. It was one of the most wildest, just that last year before everything started to wind down. Of course, the world ended. It seemed to like WrestleZone was really picking up on these moments that people outside of this bubble in the Northeast were actually picking up on, which unfortunately has been cut short, of course. So yeah. Went from that, you teamed with them, and then somehow you end up as tag team champions before the world ended. So it seemed to be that Connor, you learned the spirit of Christmas, and that's ended up as champion. So I guess another bit of a different side of you, because it's more of a comedic side of Crystal Craib. Again,
for different
for those kind of skits, and that was again where you had a lot of input in the content, or were you kind of directed?
Yeah, man. I showed up at training with my Christmas jumper, so I was ready for it. We both had like input, you know, and we were all just having fun with it. We were just coming up with mad ideas, like what we could do. And, you know, obviously these ideas haven't happened yet because of the pandemic. But, you know, yeah, I'm actually enjoying that, like, comedic side. Because I was looking forward to me and Connor against Alan and Caleb at the Rumble. Because that was planned, you know, after we did a... Yeah, it was for the Rumble. And I just thought me and Alan could have, like, a lot of fun with that. I really wanted to do more. So hopefully we'll stick to it when we come back.
I hope so, because Alan Sterling's one of the funniest wrestlers that people should know.
And see, what you see in the ring is what we see in the back, it traded. That is just Alan 24/7. It's crazy. I don't even have the volume turned up.
I still love mixed martial Alan. It's still one of my favorite things to ever watch. I still occasionally I'll go back and watch the vignettes with him doing that, because it was just it was so funny.
I really liked the one when he was Lord Alan Sterling and he was in the farm. That's one of my favorite ones. That's just amazing, that one.
And then Malice, of course, continued the tradition of calling you Cruncher Crab.
Yeah. I didn't expect that on my return as well. Came up with that. I was like, almost breaking me here. Hurry up so I can boot you.
So just a little bit before that, before the official face turn, of course, I'm skipping Aberdeen Anarchy 2019. Of course, you're in the ring with Bingo Balance and Lionheart, which is a bit weird because about 3-4 weeks prior, I'd seen you wrestle Lionheart in ICW in Aberdeen. Yeah. Of course, Lionheart's no longer with us. Everyone knows that. So what was it like? I know Lionheart was about in the early days of WrestleZone, but what was it like getting into the ring with him in ICW and one of his last matches?
In the early days of WrestleZone, he used to come along and give us like private seminars, you know, like maybe once a month or something, and we learned a lot from him. And he taught us a lot of just little things. And when I got to work with him, he was always one guy I really wanted to work with. And when I got the chance to work with him in ICW, he was open to just like everything. He just said, whatever you want to do to me tonight, just let me know. We'll just have fun. And yeah, he said, this is your night to shine, you know, because obviously it's your first time being in ICW. So he really wanted me to do as much as I wanted to do in that match. So yeah, I had a blast working with him. The Aberdeen Anarchy match, the triple threat, it didn't go, it wasn't like the greatest thing, but it was a good enough match. I enjoyed it. And I always love working with Bingo. He's a great guy as well. So yeah.
I remember from that ICW match, just I didn't expect it to be as competitive just because he was the champion at the time. I thought it would be a bit more one-sided, but no, I'm glad that it was one of the matches where it had a WrestleZone guy and the crowd kind of reacted appropriately, because of course there was the other match which I don't think aired, Scotty Swift and Aaron Echo, where everyone was confused what to react to and how to react, because what was happening.
Yeah, I heard about this.
Yeah, Scotty was like kind of the heel, but he's in Aberdeen, so people were cheering him. And then Aaron Echo was supposed to be the face, but he was being a bit of a dick to the crowd. So there's my one. So people didn't know how to react. It was just a very awkward match. So I was kind of worried when you came out. I was like, oh, I hope this isn't like that. But it was just, yeah, it definitely worked. So moving about from WrestleZone, you did some stuff in Rock and Wrestle as well, which is how we had our long car journey. And a very small Clio with yourself in the front, Joey Legend in the back, and then my wife, because I picked her up halfway. We got to Elgin. Yeah. You started with Switch. So you came in, did squash, booted him, and that was it. And then you had a bit of a ongoing feud with Aspen Faith, who I'm aware is one of your closer friends as well.
Yeah.
So what was it like getting to work with, and I know we will mention just the chaotic street fight. What was it like working with Aspen in Rock and Wrestle and Sammy and all that?
It was weird. It was like, it was just like, I'm wrestling Aspen, it's just a different ring. You know, like me and Aspen, we love working with each other, you know, because I think it's, we just like trust each other a lot, like with what we want to do. And I think we're quite similar in what we want to do in the matches and stuff. And the only thing I didn't like about the street fight was obviously when Sammy took my black hole, she ended up getting injured and she ended up in hospital that night. So we were in hospital for like a couple of good hours. So yeah, like other than that, I always enjoy working with Aspen. So, yeah.
Yeah, I remember when after the match happened, I went to Instagram and I saw Sammy with a, we're laughing about it now because it's fine, but a broken collarbone, and I was just like, Jesus, that's just, I mean.
That's from a black hole as well. That's just mental, because I class that as like probably like my safest move in my arsenal, you know. It's just like, I'm just placing you there. Whereas like, because it was the only move she was taking in the match, she just went for it. So, like, when I swung her, she was all the way up here. I'm like, whoa, what's going on? And just as soon as I landed, it was like, oh, God. She's done. So, yeah.
But it's just one of those... I'm so surprised that was the moment, because I think I remember at some point you threw Aspen off the stage. Yeah, there's so many things that could have went wrong, and that was it. The safest move that could have done, and it was the one that caused the injury. And he also popped up in Discovery Wrestling in 2018 as well in the Derby. Is that a company that did they approach you, or were you trying to like, I want to get involved with Disco?
It was obviously they had Disco Derby coming up, and Aspen and Sammy put my name forward and said to Alan, "Oh, you need to really get Crusher." And then from that point, he messaged me, and it was a done deal. So yeah, that was pretty much it.
Was there any other companies that you're kind of wanting to get to when shows get back? Because I think you've covered pretty much all the big ones in Scotland, certainly now.
I think so, yeah. I'm happy with where I work. I don't think there's any other be like jumping to work there. So yeah, happy with what I've done.
Just to continue with WrestleZone. I've got a note about face paint because you started to bring that in towards the end of your current run. The one that I'm really curious about, I mean, I'll ask about your inspirations with the face paint, but the purple face paint that you had for Anarchy 19, what right. was that inspired by? Because I didn't know. I thought it was a Sentinel from X-Men.
I think I got told that as well. But do you know what? There was nothing behind it. I just showed up at Ballroom, and whenever I've got face paint on, it's always Aspen that does it for me. It's not me. So like Aspen was like, "What do you want?" I'm like, "I don't know, just something cool," you know, because Aspen, he's just great at just coming up with things, and he just did that, and I'm like, "I don't even know what I have." the only one I actually requested for Aspen was the Punisher one, because I really wanted to like have the Punisher lines, and that was the only one I actually kind of asked for. But like, Aspen is so creative that when he puts face paint on you, he just makes you look like a badass. So like, when I always do the big shows, it's like, yeah, I'm gonna get Aspen to make me look like a badass, a bigger badass than what I look like. So yeah, there's no reasoning behind the purple ones. So yeah, sorry.
Well, that's all right. At least I've got it from on the horse's mouth now. There was no reason, and I can just make it up in my head. But yeah, it's exactly that. The bigger the show, you go all out. It's like when you see the wrestlers at WrestleMania, they've always got their fancier gear for the big shows.
Yeah.
So I think that's pretty much most of my notes here. So we'll go over to the fan questions that we've got, and I'll start with Facebook so I don't have to look over here for it. So we'll start with Connor. Connor Inglis has asked, do you want some turkey?
Yeah, once his mum's ready, give me some.
Don't know how to react to that one. Just move on. We've got Christopher Ogg. I can't see your surname. Sorry, Christopher. So we'll yeah. stay with that.
My number one fan.
Castanay, we'll go with. Yeah. I do have a note about it, but he's asked the question, so that's all good. He's with successful, oh God, those words I can't say, with successful fundraising campaigns for charities behind him and many satisfyingly crushing wrestling achievements to date. Right, he's put a question mark there. That's wrong. What is Crusher's most satisfying moment this far in the Scottish wrestling scene? So what's your most satisfying moment in wrestling so far in Scotland?
I think making it to the Ballroom. You know, I think it was the most satisfying moment for all of us. You know, just because we'd worked so hard performing in front of the crowds that we normally did, like, you know, of 150, 200, maybe even the littlest of 50 people, and going to like a big venue like that where 1,000 people, and we had people like Billy Gunn and Hacksaw on the same show. I think that was my favorite overall moment that I've had in Scottish wrestling, and obviously main event in the first Ballroom show with Johnny Lyons. I think that was very special to me. So, yeah.
Just to mention about like getting the imports and people coming through. I don't feel it's to wrestling daft at all, but Grado continually sings your praises anytime that Aberdeen and WrestleZone's brought up. So he must have made an impression, especially on him anyway.
Yeah. He's a great guy as well. When I got to work with him in WrestleZone, he was just open to everything. Such a nice guy. He's exactly what you'd expect backstage. Exactly what you see. When I was at ICW as well to wrestle Lionheart, when Grado saw me, he came running over and hugged me and says, "I'm so happy you're on the show." And he was saying that he kind of wished that he got to wrestle me on ICW. So I thought that was really nice of him. You know, he's a nice guy. Really love him.
So maybe that's one for the future. He's also asked, and also, who is one that you'd like to crush the most, but has not yet had? That's not yet a chance to. So who would be opponent that you'd like to face?
Caleb Valhalla.
Oh yes.
That's gonna happen.
That's a match I want for an Aberdeen Anarchy.
I think we could have a good match. Definitely.
It won't be the prettiest, I don't think, but you'll be sitting there going, oh no.
Hard hitting. That's going to be fun if it ever happens. Yeah.
Are you quite a hard hitting? I mean, of course, I've seen you wrestle, but are you quite a hard hitting wrestler? Do you like to, like Bradley Evans was on about, he liked taking pain, which I thought was absolutely ridiculous. But are you that kind of same scope where you don't mind getting a bit of a heavy hit?
No, I don't mind as long as you don't break my nose or, you know, I'm comfortable with people being snug. I'm snug in the ring. I kind of have to be with my character, you know, because I have to make my stuff look really devastating. So, yeah, I don't mind a bit of snug. So it's good to have that in wrestling because you don't want, like, someone that kind of holds back, and when they hit people, it doesn't look good. I think your stuff, yeah, I prefer snug.
Yeah, prefer to, if someone's going to hit you hard, it kind of gives you a bit of a permission as well to, I'm going to hit you hard back,
yeah,
because you've hit me.
It's a rule that me and Scotty Swift have got, like, you know, like when we're in the ring together, it's like, yeah, let's just do it, you know, we trust each other, so we'll just go for it. So, yeah.
I mean, we'll go back just because you mentioned Scotty. We already spoke about your injury and your hip and what have you. What was the scariest part of coming back? I mean, you did the big boot as your first move, which I assume is not the easiest one to think of, especially because it's hips. But was that first match, were you quite trepidatious about going into it?
I was actually okay because before I returned to the ballroom, I was actually in ring training before ballroom. And I could have wrestled at the ballroom, but I said to the guys that I'd rather take the time to make sure that my body can handle what I'm doing, especially with the hip. So yeah, it was just getting back to basics for that, like 4 months or whatever before Battle of Nations. So I was ready. I was definitely ready.
That's fine. Right, so back, we'll go to the Twitter now. And we've got four odd questions, which we'll have a lot of fun with.
Four odd.
Well, there's definitely maybe one. I'll go for the first one. So Conan has asked, who'd win in a fight, the Crusher Milkshake Cat or the Nesquik Bunny?
Crusher Milkshake Cat.
I don't need a reason. It's fine. It's fine. So we've also got Scotty Swift asking, who's your least favorite opponent and why?
You know what the funny thing is, Scott already knows the answer to this. I'll just say it briefly. I'm not going to get into it because I'm not going to make it a negative, or like, you know, the podcast negative or anything. Say the least favorite person I've worked with is Congo Kevin Williams, simply just because I think he was unprofessional. I'll leave it at that.
Well, we'll draw underline on that. So we'll spin into positive. Most favorite opponent to work with?
Oh, jeez.
Does have to be one. You can mention a couple if that's any easier.
I think the most favourite match I've been a part of is Big Damo, because I think I learned a lot working with Big Damo, because I got to go down to his wrestling school with some of the guys, and he's got a great mind. I really enjoyed learning from Big Damo. Other wrestlers I've enjoyed working with is Noam Dar. I really like working with him. Bingo Balance, Scotty Swift, Aspen Faith, Zach Dynamite, Bradley Evans. I actually really, really enjoy working with Bradley. Try to think of who else. Damien. Oh, yeah, Damien. I think Damien's the most underrated wrestler in Scotland. He should be everywhere. And Sean Johnson. They would be the guys I would pick.
So that's just the majority of the core wrestling roster. But yeah, it's a. I suppose when you wrestle that often as well, not only is it you enjoy it, but it's quite easy because you know what each other does, and it's not a case of you having to come in and go, right, what's your signatures, what's your move, what do you want to do? It's like, right, okay, this is what you do usually, I'll do this, there we go, right, out we go, all good. So yeah, that's matches I've seen pretty much all of them, except I didn't see Halloween Hijinks, you and Damo, and I got it. I'm sure it's on DVD.
I think it's on DVD. Oh, it was I really enjoyed that. That was my favourite big man match I've had. Definitely.
I mean, you had during your, I think maybe your second, maybe probably your first run, you had so many, you had Jackie Polo, I think, at one point, didn't you, as well?
Yeah. No, that was another good match as well. Just different stuff in the match. It was really, really good to learn from him. Yeah.
So we've got Dino Del Monte. He's asked, you're a six-man tag. Your partners are Bronson and who else?
Oh, God. Okay, Charlie Bronson. And I probably have to pick Bradley Evans because he'll be upset if I don't pick him.
I remember when we did the tournaments that I can't say the name of the team and Bronson was brought up. Is that a thing outside of wrestling? I know you like movies, so we'll probably get onto that in a second. But is Bronson someone that
it's just one of them things, like when you have like a lazy day and you're like, right, I fancy watching a movie. I'll watch this Bronson movie. I've never seen it before. It doesn't look that great. I watched it and I just thought, this movie is absolutely ridiculous. What's going on? And I messaged Bradley, and then Bradley started watching it. And he loves it as well. Like, obviously, Bronson's like favorite word throughout that whole movie is our nickname for that team. And we just started using it on each other. And like, we're even in like a group chat together with just that name, call each other that. It's just like, yeah, the movie was just awesome. It's nuts.
So for those that are waiting, see you next Tuesday. You can gather it from there. And Bradley's asked, he got involved, he put, which comic and movie characters would you like to team up with the most?
Okay, movie character, no doubt it'll be Terminator. I'm a massive Terminator fan. Even the entrance would be amazing. Coming down on motorbikes and the song You Could Be Mine, Guns N' Roses. That'd be cool. Comic book character. I'd say Batman.
That's quite a combo. Batman, Crusher Craib, Terminator.
Plus Batman in a wrestling match means he's got prep time, so we're winning.
So, I mean, you brought up Terminator again. There's another thing I'm very aware of, that you're well into your movies, and I know that Terminator is one of your favourites. Again, this is from this very brief two-hour drive that we had. I remember these things, but what is it about Terminator? Was it something you watched when it came? Was it something you caught?
Trust me, man. When I was little, I watched all the movies that you should not be watching when you were a kid, and Terminator was one of them. I was just a massive fan. I loved Arnie when I was a kid. And I at one point when I was like 14, I had like every single movie of his on VHS. Like, I was a big Arnie mark. So yeah, I love Arnie. So Terminator 2 is the best movie of all time, in my opinion. You know, just my opinion. But after Terminator 2, that's when the franchise died. Just the first two. It was good.
Did you enjoy Rise of the Machines now?
No, that was horrible. I didn't like the guy that casted as John Connor either. It was not good.
I remember I went to see Salvation in the cinema, and it was not long. I had surgery on my lower back area, so I couldn't sit for long, but this is the first time I was allowed out of the house for any period of time. So I went to see Terminator Salvation. And, oh my God, it was the worst film I've ever seen in the cinema. And I saw Bringing Down the House, and I've seen some terrible films. But I sat; it was very empty. It was cinema too, so it was a small cinema in Elgin at the time. And I sat there, and about an hour and a half in, it was like, I don't know, something about, he needs a heart. And I just shouted, oh, give him yours. I'll give you my heart. It's like, oh, for God's sake, why am I here? I need to go.
Yeah, no. You know what? The Salvation movie, I really liked the idea of it. It was just terrible. You know, I liked the idea of it being set in the future, but it could have been done so much better. So much better.
I mean, I'm grip it, so I'm never going to walk out of a movie, but it's the closest I've ever come to just going, nah, I don't care what happens in this, I'm going home, and it's just awful. So it's outside of wrestling, when you were, you said you went to training when you were injured in that, but it's outside of wrestling, is that pretty much your kind of passions, movies, and or have you got anything else on the go?
I like movies, I like comics, well, since the pandemic, my children have actually gotten me into Fortnite, so I've been playing Fortnite a lot, and Sammy, Aspen, Bradley, they all play it as well, so that's kind of our way of catching up, you know, just like getting a headset on, playing a few games and kind of rather than meeting up. So other than that, all I really do is just like spend time with the kids and do stuff with them. But yeah, pretty boring.
Fortnite, I couldn't get it. Everything was going too fast for me, and I was just like, no, can't do this anymore. I'll stick with the only thing I play now is WWE games or Uncharted, maybe, if I'm feeling a bit.
Uncharted's a good game. I like Uncharted.
I replayed most of the first two again when they came out in the PlayStation Store for free. I was like, I'm having them, even though I played them years ago. but yeah, I absolutely love them. So you said comics. I'm assuming you mentioned Batman as someone they'd have on your team. Is there a distinction? Are you a DC guy, Marvel guy, or just a comic guy?
See, you know, one thing I don't like about comics, they've got something very similar with wrestling. You get like wars between Marvel and DC. I'm not a big fan of that. I like both, but I'm a bigger fan of DC. You know, I like both, but I'm more of a DC guy. I know more of the DC characters. But yeah, Batman's my main comic that I would read. If I'm on Marvel, I'll probably read a bit of Spider-Man or Venom.
Did you enjoy the Zack Snyder's Cut?
I prefer DC just because it's more gritty. I loved it. I absolutely loved it. I watched the whole thing. Amazing.
We're not on the same page for that.
Sorry, man.
I
love it.
It's that thing. It's like I'm not here to go, you're wrong, but I couldn't. I didn't like the first cut. So I didn't like.
We're all entitled to our own opinion. I absolutely loved it. Bradley as well. He loved it as well. I just thought it was really good. I really dig Ben Affleck as Batman.
Oh yeah.
I just wish we could get a movie with him.
There's so many things I liked the characters, but 4 hours. Come on,
What I did was I watched 2 hours of it because it went in parts. So like I stopped it at the 2 hour mark because I just finished night shift. I went to bed and when I woke up, I watched the other 2 hours. Much easier that way. I enjoyed it.
What they were saying about putting out as a miniseries, I think I would have enjoyed it more as a miniseries. I still probably would have watched it in a block as 4 hours. Mm-hmm. But I think at least I could have digested it a little bit more that way, or at least had the choice to. Anyway, but I was like, no, I'm here now. I've got 6 hours before my wife gets home from work. I'll just get through this.
You watched it all in one, did you?
Yeah.
Oh man, I wouldn't have done that. I'd be dying at the end of that.
I mean, for the first one, I think it was the first one. I never saw the end of the first cut of it because I got a copy which wasn't quite legal and it cut off the last 10 minutes of the film. So I never saw the end of it.
But the theatrical cut?
Yeah. So I never saw it.
It ended with Flash's Superman having a race to see who was faster.
Oh God, I think I'm glad I didn't see this.
I was just saying that it was a bit the theatrical cut was just a bit more cheesy. They just had like cheesy lines, like at the end when they wanted to race each other. Superman was like, "Oh, Bruce said if I beat you, you have to buy us brunch," and I'm like, "What is going on here?" It's cheesy.
No, I'm much more into the Marvel side of things. Although I loved Shazam.
But I think Shazam just, was great, man. I loved Shazam too.
I think it's just because it's the most MCU film that DC put out. I loved every second of it. I knew nothing about Shazam going into it, and they're just great. Because you got kids, I'm assuming you got Disney Plus. So have you been delving into the
I've got Disney Plus. I've kept up to date with all the Marvel movies. I've not watched WandaVision yet. I am planning on watching it. I'm not too keen on the look of Winter Soldier and Falcon. I think it kind of looks boring, but don't know how it is.
It's just bias, but I've watched the series through Falcon and Winter Soldier twice now, so it's pretty good. It depends on your taste, I suppose. At the end of the day, WandaVision, I think it's a matter of taste as well, because the first couple of episodes are a bit odd with like the sitcom-y stuff.
Yeah, I've heard that.
It picks up. So just down to taste. But that's pretty much it. If I'm going to the cinema now, it's superhero films. That's about it.
I'm pretty much the same. Yeah.
Right, so I'll go back to some of my stupid questions, which you're probably aware of. The first one being, what's your favourite dinosaur?
it's got to be boring, but I wasn't really a big fan of dinosaurs growing up. Didn't really interest me as a kid. Sorry. Probably T-Rex. I'll just be boring.
Just be a classic. That's absolutely fine. Everyone's entitled to their dinosaur choices.
I was more into Action Man when I was a kid. That was my thing. I was like getting all the latest Action Man toys and stuff. You remember them?
Oh yeah, I had the Action Man that had the flick at the back and his eyes moved.
That was my thing. Or Power Rangers. I used to be a massive fan of the Power Rangers. I loved that.
Amazing. But I remember the Action Man I had the parachute one, right, the one that came with the parachute. I threw it out my bedroom window.
I had that one.
Yeah, I threw it out my bedroom window. It landed in a humongous thorn bush, like right across. And that was the last time I used the parachute, because when I pulled it out, it just shredded. I had it for about a day before I did that. So I don't think my folks really wanted to buy me any more Action Men, because, you know, I didn't look after that one. And that was over. Power Rangers, just Mighty Morphin, Zeo, or how far did you get?
Just Mighty Morphin. I didn't like it when it started going on to the other ones. Just the Mighty Morphin.
And favourite?
Tommy.
Tommy. Classic choice, yeah.
I like him as the Green Ranger more than the White Ranger, though. I prefer the Green Ranger. I liked his, was it the Dragon Sword?
Oh, yeah. And he had the massive, I can't remember the name of it, which people will be shouting at me now, but the massive turtle thing as well. Titus or something like that. Hang on, I'll find out. it'll know me otherwise. Tenatus. Just sounds like you can't hear anything. Tommy Oliver. Very easy to find these things. I'll find it in a sec. Tommy's the best. Jason was my guy. Red Ranger.
Jason was cool as well. Yeah.
My other stupid question is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
One cow?
Any particular reason, or is it just off the cuff?
I don't know, just because it's bigger, I guess.
So yeah, it depends how much thought you put into it. Some people are like, is it a ram? Is it a Highland cow?
Okay.
But if you go for cow, that's absolutely fine. It's your prerogative at the end. So outside of wrestling, we've mentioned movies, mentioned all that kind of stuff. You also, before lockdown happened, you raised some money for charity and shaved your head. So what was the thought behind doing that?
What, both of them or just like...
Both, yeah.
Yeah. Well, the first, like, I've always wanted to do something for charity, and I thought, like, you know, with the wrestling, I thought it would be good to kind of, like, promote something so people could help out. And I thought, like, obviously, a Little Princess Trust is obviously about children that, you know, obviously lose their hair and all that. And kind of makes me think, you know, like, what if that was my two kids, you know? And so, yeah, it kind of makes you think all things like that. So that's how I started off the Little Princess Trust. And the second one with shaving my head, I love animals. I specifically love dogs. So, yeah. Speaks for you, so it speaks for itself. I just love dogs, so I just decided I'll shave all my hair off, raise some money.
And once you did it, I was like, oh, classic look, it's a good look, the whole bald head beard. Is that a look that you're maintaining? Are you going to continue with the look?
Still bald.
Much easier to manage.
It is, and I quite like it, yeah. It's much better than getting up every day and having to brush your hair, find a hair bobble. I live in a house with three women, well, two girls and a woman. So, like, it's hard to find hair bobbles sometimes, you know? So, like, where are they all? I prefer having no hair. Screw that.
It's just, yeah, it's much easier. I mean, now when mine grows out, I've got a full head of hair, but no one believes me because it's so fair at the top. It gets that whole horseshoe thing going, and it's just... I'm 30. I don't want to look 50 at this point in life. I think that's pretty much wrapped up all my kind of questions that we've got here. So we'll go for future, stuff in the future. We already mentioned that you're quite happy in WrestleZone, not fuss for going elsewhere. Just wanting to do what you do. But let's say dream matches, if you wrestle anyone, who would it be?
Undertaker.
Course, I knew it was gonna be Undertaker Did you base kind of a lot of your offense, because I know you did the big boot, and of course Black Hole Slam is more of an Abyss thing, but did you kind of any other big men that you kind of picked and choose moves from?
I would say that obviously Undertaker would be the main guy I would look at. The only thing was I didn't really want to use too much of what he done, because I didn't want people thinking, oh, he's just taking all his stuff, you know. I don't think I really use any move that he does, apart from the odd choke slam now and then. And then I think the other guy I watched was Vader, you know, because Vader, like, obviously when he punches, he's just punching them though, you know. It's he's just got crazy strikes. But yeah, him, and I liked watching stuff with Brock in his early run. And I think that's pretty much it for the bigger guys that I watch.
And outside of them, when you're watching wrestling, is there anyone that you particularly like watching wrestle? Other than Undertaker, of course.
What, from nowadays?
Past, present, future, whoever. What you enjoy watching?
Well, I'll go through a few. I'd say, like, nowadays, I would probably say AJ Styles or Roman Reigns. I like Roman. Past, Bret Hart and Shawn Michaels. And I like the Macho Man. And Razor Ramon, Scott Hall. And I like Sting, obviously, because I was brought up with him, like seeing him on the TV. So, yeah, I would say that was my main guys, I would say.
Awesome. Right, I know that you're pressed for time, so we'll finish up with your social media. So if people want to know more about Crusher Craib, how can they find out about you?
They can find me on Facebook under Crusher Craib, Instagram Crusher Craib. This is all just one word, no space, obviously, for the username. Twitter Crusher Craib and TikTok Crusher Craib.
TikTok. Oh, no, I remember seeing TikTok. You putting any on your own? You can put some more your own stuff on
I've put on, like, I think three videos. I'm actually just enjoying watching what's going on TikTok. It's actually, there's a lot of funny stuff on there. It's crazy.
It's the easiest hour you can waste and come out of it going, I have no idea what I watched. It's all a blur. But yeah, like I said, I'll leave it to you. Thank you very much for joining me today.
No problem. I'm sure
once shows come back up again, I'll try and grab you again for another chat, and we'll speak about upcoming matches and all that kind of gubbings.
No problem, man.
Thank you very much for joining me today.
Well, thank you, man. Appreciate it.